We had such confidence in the group that something big was going to happen from now on.
The first time they actually worked together was when Bjorn and Benny made their first album called Bjorn and Benny, I think.
We had recorded as single artists, all of us, and we had a smash hit with one of Benny's and my songs called Gamle Man, Old Man.
Which was a Swedish sort of Salvation Army rip-off song. And they wanted some choir parts by their fiancés, who happened to be Agneta and Frida.
I was the first one to work with Michael, and we only worked with him from then on.
I recorded their separate careers before they formed ABBA, so I knew them all but Benny, who was on a different company.
People need hope, people need loving, people need trust from a fellow man.
A song called People Need Love was the first one we recorded together in English and as a group, although we called ourselves Frida, Agneta, Benny and Bjorn at that time. And that must have been like 71-ish, something like that. But this was specifically for a single with the four of us as a group. Ring Ring was a small hit in Germany, Holland and the Scandinavian countries, but it never made it here. Nothing happened here as usual. I mean, the record companies were stone cold. Oh, from Sweden, my God. Forget it. It just wasn't on, you know. but we needed a good English lyric for it. We thought, you know, it would be an added bonus to have someone famous doing it. And Stig Andersson, our manager and publisher, happened to know Neil Sedaka from before. So he sent a tape and asked them, would you like to translate this? And they did, very quickly too. But that year before the Eurovision Song Contest in Brighton, 74, we traveled a lot and did a lot of television in Northern Europe. So that was quite good for us. We were prepared for what was going to come. Something I remember very, very well is that my costume was so tight that I couldn't sit down in it. It was terrible, and I cursed myself for not, you know, slimming a bit before that thing.
It never happened before that a Eurovision winner actually caught the audience so big.
They didn't let me on stage when the writers were to make their entrance. There was this guard who thought, you're not a writer, you misunderstood this, you dumb Swede. You have to wait. No, I am a writer. No, you're not. So Benny and Stig went on stage and I didn't. I was allowed up when the artist was allowed up.
And nobody really thought it would happen anything more than winning, and that would be nice to win. But not that this was something to build a career on.
There was a feeling something really big had happened, and that the world lay at our feet. Once we started our relationship as songwriters, doing it sort of every day, we would get together something like around 10 o'clock, either at my home or his.
They lived locally, just a couple of minutes away from the studio. They had their houses at Lidingö. Lidingö, that's spelled with two dots over it, which is an island just outside Stockholm.
And we'd sit there, you know, hour after hour, we really would. And sometimes something would come up, and usually it didn't. Nothing good anyway. We just continues to slog on, you know. And then usually something would come up, like possibly three or four songs, without any lyrics or anything, just the songs. And that's when we would go into the studio. We would try, of course, the keys with Agnetha and Frida. I would write a dummy lyric, and we would write down the chords, and just give the chords to the guys. And all those guys, those musicians, were very, very creative themselves as well. So everyone was coming up with, you know, ideas all the time.
Bjorn always used to write these fake lyrics. The guide vocal lyrics could be about mashed potatoes or something, a love song about mashed potatoes, and he did 5 or 6 of them sometimes. He was very fluent. He could write a lyric for a song in 5 minutes, and it would be good, but silly.
I try to keep some kind of atmosphere, something that would fit the song's feeling, even though it was just a dummy.
And then they started to play the song. Most of the time, either the girls or Bjorn would sing these fake lyrics. And one idea gave another idea, and so it went on.
When we had put down the basic backing track, you would usually add some overdubs, like strings, synths, a little, you know, just to make it a bit more interesting. Then I would take that tape home and I would write the lyric. I always had the feeling that if I'd listened long enough, the song itself would tell me roughly what it was about. That was my theory, and it worked most of the time.
The songs turn out their own way. And sometimes you can't dominate a song. It dominates you, or it dominates the recording. So nobody can really tell what's going to happen in the studio.
And so I had a lyric, and we went in the studio with the girls. If Agnetha had had 3 tracks by then, it was Frida's turn, and, you know, very fair. And they would then sing, and after that, more overdubs. Until we thought, you know, now we're sort of, how we there. And then we'd mix it, and that would be it.
The saddest story is the Summer Night City song, which was a really good song, and it never came out right. It was a typical example of how they live their own lives, these songs. It should be like this or that, and you can't tame it, sort of. So this song never actually came out the way it should sound, and we tried it, and we tried it, and we tried different. We have 50 mixes of it.
Changing and changing back and trying different directions.
I've never used so much compressor on any song that we thought of, maybe if we overdo everything, maybe it will work. But of course it didn't. It's still a good song, and it's a fairly good recording, but not the way it was supposed to be. It would have been much better. There was something in the air that night. The
stars were bright, Fernando. I can remember all those moments when we thought, oh my God, this is good. This is great. Winner Takes It All, Mamma Mia, Fernando and Dancing Queen. Well, really all of those big ones we had a feeling for, having written them, that this is really staggering. This I can be proud of. But every song worth recording should be a possible single. It was never like recording 20 and seeing whether there was 1 or 2 out of those 20. It was writing 3, 4, which usually, at least, each one could be a single. And then, you know, seeing the results and seeing that it didn't turn out as strong as we thought, but it's very, very good. It's good for the album.
When an album was put together, then it was all the best songs that could be thought of, and all the songs that turned out best during the recordings.
We got rid of the rubbish in the writing period. So we never went into the studio with something half finished or something that was not knowing it is probably not good enough. It was only four or five things that we now have released as, you know, curiosities left. Chiquitita, you and I
know. This is the Polar Studio, which we built in 78. And we started at Metronome Studio, where I was employed. And when we built this studio, it was to recreate the Metronome Studio, because that's one of the best studios ever built. And had, you know, Lux Studios can have magic in the walls and a history. So that's a great place to be, and we try to create a place like that for ourselves. And outside here, you can see it's a sort of a ramp, and the fans started to park their Volkswagens there and sleep there. And then we had to push our way through the doors every morning for all the fans who were standing, who had been sleeping there outside the studio. And they looked very much alike, burning eyes and hair, But they were very hardcore fans who used to follow them or just sit outside waiting for them for hours. We came in here around 10, and around 10, 11, 12 at night, we locked up the studio and went home, and they were still there waiting just to get a glimpse. You know, I'm a big Elvis fan, but I wouldn't wait for Elvis outside the studio for 12, 15 hours just to call a glimpse of it. Strange. Knowing me, knowing you, there is nothing
we can do. Knowing me, knowing you. I certainly didn't look upon us as a live band. It was nice, you know, every now and then to meet the fans, meet the audience. Other than that, it took away from the time creating new songs, didn't it? Because writing on the road didn't work for us.
Our aim was to make American records, because they sounded the best and they had the best feel, and it was quite different from the English records in that period.
We listened to the Billboard chart, the English chart, everything in it, and albums too, all the time, constantly.
Bjorn and Benny, especially Benny, listened to so many strange kinds of music. He listened to classical music a lot, and so I was the one who brought the records to the studio and said, listen here.
It's inheriting what other people have done and doing it your own way and then sending it off to younger people.
Here's a great way to do the drum part, or this is a nice way to do this or that.
You cannot create pop music isolated, I don't think.
They were sort of molded into their time by everything around. It wasn't specifically aimed at any special target, let's make a Bee Gees record or something like that. Yeah, Dancing Queen was they were very confident about Dancing Queen, because that was a really good piece of music, and it was so together, and the swing and the feel to it was quite different from everything they did before and after, actually, I think.
But that certainly was you know, more international than European, Dancing Queen. I didn't expect Fernando to be number one in America, because it's more like European tradition. But knowing me, knowing you, could have been number one. SOS, lots of other songs.
A few years back, I took out the 24 Crackmaster and suddenly remembered, because there was a slight piece of a record before the actual recording where I have copied over Rock Me Baby. And we used that as a guide for the feel of the swing. So that's a very typical example. How, of course, we didn't use anything of that in any other respect, and just to have a few bars of it ahead of the real song, that's the way we should put it, because we're Swedish, and that's quite different from being Americans or English, because we weren't brought up with this music. We sort of listened through England to the American records. So this was a thing we had to make our own. It wasn't natural.
No, there were more that, to me, could have been number ones, but never were. And I know the reason. It's because we didn't spend any time there. Because at that time, to be able to break it in America, it seemed you'd have to tour months and months and months and go to all these radio stations and all do all that stuff, which we didn't want to do. Just didn't have the time for that. I mean, when you could break a single by doing one television program in Germany, and that was it, you'd have to spend 2 months in America.
One of my favorites is One of Us, very much because of the bass line played by Rutger Gunnarsson, who's a genius. You must never forget the musicians that did this with ABBA, because they were top-rate, top-notch musicians, and they did such incredible jobs.
They were the best in the country, and they were, you know, if you'd compare them to English and American musicians at that time, they would be equally good, no doubt in my mind.
If you sit down and think, I should listen to One of Us now, let's hear it. And I should listen just to the bass, and you concentrate on the bass, and then you go, and it's so good, and it's so humorous, and so swinging. That's a good piece of music.
Mamma Mia, which was the one that took us back to number one in Britain after that terrible period between Waterloo and when everyone thought that this is a Eurovision group, they're supposed to be dead, what are they doing still here? You know, so it was such an uphill struggle, so that's why I love Mamma Mia.
One of my strangest favorites is Two for the Price of One because of the words, because they're so tight and they swing so good. So tremendous piece of work he did there, and they're funny. So to me, that's the best words he ever put to any ABBA song, Bjorn. I can still recall.
Our Last Summer, which was written with a certain girl in mind that I had a romance with in Paris as a teenager. So that's very real to me. And the other one that comes to mind is Slipping Through My Fingers, which I wrote about my seven-year-old Linda when she left home all by herself to go to school for the first time. The winner takes it all, the loser has to fall. The Winner Takes It All is very fond to me as well, because for once that lyric came in, like, I think it was ready in 2 hours. So it was unusual, completely out of the ordinary. And still on top of this, I'm pretty sure it must have rained
the day before you came. The day before you came, I think that's... Oh, that's a really moving piece.
I think it was something that was completely misunderstood by the public, or it was too early or something like that. But it was so different from anything we'd done that I think it ended up at number 20 or something like that.
It was very emotional, because that was the last ABBA song we ever did, and it sort of felt this, now it's over. And it's so incredibly performed by Agneta. So I think that's a really special track.
We might have continued for a while longer if that had been a number one or something. But since it wasn't, we felt this is the time. The girls also wanted to go off and do their thing. Benny and I was into writing a musical. The time was right.
Oh yes, I'm sure my life was well within its usual frame. The day before you came.
One night in Bangkok, in the world's job buster. The bars are temples, but the pulls ain't free.
A friend of mine who also worked on Chess, Judy Kramer, she'd had this idea about doing something with based on ABBA music. It struck me that an upbeat musical with a good story and lots of hit songs is something, you know, very nice to go to see and has great potential. It's the kind of thing I would like to see myself. The other original idea that came was that we were to keep the lyrics in their original and to weave a story around them. And this is no mean task. I mean, this is very difficult, obviously. But we found this wonderful dramatist from Bristol, Catherine Johnson. And she has come up with a story where the songs fit as though they were written for it. And it's about a mother and a daughter. It's on a Greek island, a sort of holiday resort. And the daughter is getting married when the musical opens. She doesn't know who her dad is. Her mother has never told her. But she has, by coincidence, found her mother's diary from that time when she was conceived. And she had relationships with three men in a short time. So these three guys could be her dad, any one of them. So her mother, not knowing, she sends letters and invites them to her wedding. And they arrive, and that's where the story. I don't want to tell you any more than that. That's where it starts. Well, we've said, Benny and I, that we definitely want to write a fourth musical. But we've said we want to do that. And I can see us starting working on that maybe next autumn or something like that. But we also want to translate Christina, which is in Swedish. Because that's a story about immigrants going to America, so we think America would be the next stop for that musical.
So I say thank you for the music, the songs I'm singing.
When Polygram bought Polar back in, whatever that is, 5 years ago, and had this idea, I thought, you know, it's brilliant if they can pull it off. To literally see that there is nothing out there in the market other than the original albums, nothing else. And then creating this new one and marketing it so cleverly. It's amazing. I'm very proud that it actually happened because it really took us back with a vengeance. As a writer, I have to believe it's that part of the secret is the songs. I think the unique quality of the two girls singing together, giving it that very, very distinct sound, is also a factor. And the productions. What else can I say?
It's funny, but I had no sense of living without aim. The day before you.
We had felt that we're losing energy. It's not as great fun as it used to be in the studio. And that was something that we had said, when that happens, it's bound to happen. Let's take a break. So a break it was, and still is.